Everybody, welcome back to the channel. I am your mistress of ceremony, Lady Nika. We're going to talk about this movie, the Get Out. I went to see this movie tonight. In fact, I forewent looking at Love and Hip Hop Atlanta. I went on down there to the movie theater because a couple of people had said that it was a good movie. And then all up and down my Twitter timeline and my Facebook timeline, there were people praising to Get Out. So I wanted to go see what the movie was about. I did not intend on doing no review for this movie. I just was going down there so I could be a part of the note and partake in the conversations down in people comment boxes or the people that I like to watch that may do the review, okay? Well, upon leaving the theater, I felt a certain kind of way, so I went down to my Facebook, and I tell y'all all the time, y'all might want to start following me on Facebook, because see, that's where I sort of just pop up, child. I do more interacting on my Facebook page than I do any of my other pages, okay? I do be on, I will respond to you eventually on IG and Twitter, but mostly I do my Facebook. That's what I like to do. That's for me. And so I decided tonight, because it's about 2-something my time now. It's 2-something in the morning, child. I'm working late shift tomorrow, so I better get some sleep and stuff. But I was trying to, I was going to stay up and do videos tonight anyway. But when I went and watched this movie, my initial reaction wasn't all that positive. I still feel like even after I'm about to review this entire movie for y'all, and for those of y'all that ain't seen it, click off the damn video now, because I'm actually finna review this entire movie. I'm going scene by scene. I may skip 2 or 3 scenes, but for the most part, I'm finna tell exactly what happened on this movie. So if you have not seen The Get Out and you plan on going to see it and you don't want to know what's gonna happen, click off the video now. Well, I gave you enough time to go. If you ain't left by now, I don't know what the hell to tell you. You were warned. But I went on Facebook Live. I don't really do that Facebook Live thing, but that movie kind of had me feeling some kind of way, because when I walked out the movie theater, myself, the people I was with, was my mini-me and her best friend, and a couple of other movie theater, moviegoers, we were walking out and we were like, that was all right, but why is everybody big hyping this movie up? Why is it this movie is just so all this and all that? But when we go into the theater and actually sit down and watch it, I walked out of there feeling like, what the fuck? I mean, it was all right. And it had some, it had some key points. It was a thinking movie. It wasn't a comedy. It wasn't really all that scary. But it did make you think, and it made you realize, look at certain situations that maybe you've been in and kind of get an idea of where he was going with this. It's a thinking piece, if you ask me, okay? So I decided to, after I had did that impromptu rundown of what the movie was, I told them, because a lot of people was asking me questions about it on my Facebook Live, I told them that I would come down here on YouTube today and bring y'all a full review of the movie, and that way I've had time to digest it and to really think about it, because what I did on Facebook Live last night was just an impromptu thing. I went on there to say something. I didn't even go on there to really talk. I went on there to make a post about it and wind up hitting the live button. And I was like, bitch, fuck it. Why type it to go and say it? So that's what I did. So I decided to come on back down here and keep my word and go ahead on and do the full review for the movie, The Get Out. Now, I'm going to try to get you Love and Hip Hop Atlanta, the season premiere tonight. And then tomorrow you'll get Tangled and Twisted, episode 6, as well as the Have and Have Nots. Y'all know that's how we do it. But if I can't get all that, child, you're going to get all of that. Just be patient with me, bear with a bitch, and it's all going to come. I can't promise you the time frame that it's going to come. Well, I actually can. You'll have all these videos that I just talked about will be up before Wednesday morning. My word to y'all. So let's go on and talk about the get out, because it, child, it made me think, but then at the same time made me just wonder why people big up shit that ain't really all of that to me. I mean, I'm just one person and this is my opinion. You may feel differently. I don't have a problem with you expressing that. Put it in the panty, baby. That's all I ask you to do. And be respectful about it. Ain't no sense in getting blocked when we can have a good time with one another talking about this shit. Now, we're gonna open up this with this guy walking down the street, okay? It's nighttime. He trying to find, I guess, his girlfriend or his friend's house. And we see this white car bypass him. Now, what we ain't gonna do is that right there. Okay. Every time I'm trying to be great, so I'm trying to prohibit my mobility. But anyway, he's walking down the street. He's looking for this address. A white car passes him, but then the car turns around. Now I would have been on alert when the damn car turned around and used the sidewalk as a means to do so, but he didn't. He stayed trying. He noticed it, and he was hoping. You know, he was on that wish factor. Well, he was on the hope factor. I hope this motherfucker don't come back and mess with me. Well, by the time he decided to turn around and go back in the direction to which he was coming from, these people have gotten out the car. We don't see the people. We just see him. He looks back. He sees that both car doors, the passenger and the driver's side is open. And next thing we know, we see someone come up from behind him. We can't make out who it is. They obviously must have had drugged him or something or knocked him out, because we see him put him in the back of a trunk, and that was it. Then we switch to the scene where we are introduced to the two main characters of this show. A young black guy by the name of Chris, who is a photographer, and his white girlfriend. They are going to meet up with her parents this weekend, okay? Now, Chris got some concerns about meeting her parents because, like I said, he's black. And Rose is saying to him that it don't matter, you know, because they'll love him. In fact, her dad oftentimes says that if he could have voted for Obama for a third term, he would have done so. And she tell him, look, I'm telling you that because he gonna tell you that as well. And he kind of, you know, calms down a little bit, and he's down with going on this little trip. So, okay, we on the road again. As they going down the road to meet the parents, she scolding him because he's a smoker. She talking about the side effects of cigarettes and all of that. And they talking or whatnot. The friend done called and stuff. His best friend who works for TSA. Keep him in mind because he's a main character on here as well. He plays a pivotal role in this movie. So, you know, friend and Kyle, he done flirted with her like he probably normally do, nothing major. And they chit chat, then they get off the phone. Him and her go back to talking. Him and her would be Chris and Rose. Child, they talking. She took her eyes off that road for a brief second, and next thing we know, they hit something. We saw the shit flying off to the side of the road. When they stop, he get out, she get out, they okay. The car got a little bit of damage. They getting out to assess the damn damages. And he starts hearing this little like moaning sound. So he's drawn to go and see. Now, we wondering why the hell would he be going back there to see. It's a reason why he did that, but he's going back there, and he finds out that it's in fact a deer that they hit, and she telling him, you know, calling him back, don't want him to go check on this deer or whatever, but he's drawn to do so, and we see him walk off the road and venture into the woods where the deer is laying there dying, okay? The next scene is we're still at that spot on this country road headed to the parents' house, but the police have arrived. I guess they came out because she hit the damn deer and she called or whatever. She's explaining who she is, where she headed, and how the accident happened, okay? Next thing we know, the police officer asks Mrs. Chris for his driver's license. He said, I ain't got no driver's license, but I got an ID. Before he could even really give the man his ID, and he's cooperating, Rose is the one with the goddamn attitude talking about he wasn't driving. I don't understand why he needs to give his ID. The reason why she ain't want that cop to take his ID, even though he let her know, anytime that you and your passengers are involved in an incident, and I got, you know, we got to come out, I have a right to ask each person for their identification. And I'm assuming that's for his report that he has to write. She don't want him to do no damn report because she don't want no paper trail. Keep that shit in mind, okay? Keep that in the memory bank. Now, we get to the parents' house. Nice home on some good little piece of land, but it's surrounding some damn woods and a lake. It's real nice. They get in there. They explain that they done hit a deer. And daddy go on this damn tirade about how deers are overpopulating the world. It's at that point I'm side-eyeing these people like, what the hell is wrong with him? You know, I'm like, Jesus. So, child, the parents, doctor. And doctor, because he's a neurosurgeon and she's a psychologist. Last name, Armitage, okay? Child, they weird. They staring at him like he knew me. They asking how long they done been together. They say about 4 months. They asked him if he smoked. He say yes. The daddy gets to talking about he ought to let the wife put him under hypnosis because he did that 15 years prior. And then ever since then, he don't fool with cigarettes no more. And every time he think about it, he feel like he about to throw up or something like that. But he ain't trying to hit it that put him under no hypnosis type of old thing. So he takes Chris on a tour of the house. And upon this tour of the house, we get to a section where he's showing pictures of the family. And there's this one picture up on the wall of the grandfather, his dad. He tells us that that man was an athlete, a top contender for the Olympics, but he was beat out by Jesse Owens. And you can tell by the way he's saying it, he wasn't cool with that, and neither was the dad, because he say that his daddy got over it almost, okay? Child, I tripped out about these people. Anyway, the next day on the deck, out back, talking with, make sure I got this right. Okay, yeah. The next day on the deck, out back, talking with the parents, and we meet Georgette the maid. Now, she's a black woman. She a weird little something, and sometimes she tend to walk a little fast, but she always smiling. Well, we get this scene where Georgette is refilling their glasses because they sitting out on the deck drinking tea and stuff. And I don't know what happened with Georgette, but she winds up going into like almost a trance and almost spilling the tea over on Chris. Now, Mrs. Armitage, with her weird ass, she tell her in a kind of rude way to go lay down. She need her rest. Georgette does what she does all the time in this movie. She busts out smiling and makes a quick exit. Later on, we see Dr. Armitage taking Chris out walking toward the grounds. And he notices that they got a black groundskeeper, okay? So he's trying to assure Chris that it ain't how it seems. Yeah, the fuck it is, baby. Anytime they go through the process of trying to tell you that something ain't what you think it is, you time it is. He talking about, you know, it looks funny for a white family to have black servants. Chris was like, yeah, but he ain't tripping about the shit. He explains that, over-explain it. Just like when you ask them, you know, are you racist? And they go, no, I love black people. I got black friends. I got 6 of them, child, okay? Well, he's sitting up there. He's telling him that Georgette and that guy, I don't remember his name, they took care of his parents. And when his parents passed away, he just didn't have it in him to fire them or let them go. So he kept them on, and that's why they're there. He also lets us know that they are in a very good area. It's secluded, and the next house is way across the lake. Bear that in mind, okay? Now, let's... let me back up a minute. When they was at that apartment preparing for Chris and her to go on that road trip to see the parents, he called his TSA friend then. Friend was telling him, shit, man, you sure you want to go and see this white girl parents? You know, I don't know. They might be, you know, trying to do some stuff, get you into sex slavery and all of that there. Child, that shit was funny. Friend was funny. Okay. Let me see where else we at right now. He wasn't that far off on that sex slave stuff. Now, let's go to the table. Let's go back to the table because I forgot some information when we was at the table. When we was at the table, we also learned that the family is having this get-together. Apparently, this is some type of event that the grandfather started. They do this shit every year at the same day. But Rose is acting like she unaware. And Mama reminded her, girl, we do this every year at the same time, so I ain't know why I had to remind you of anything, okay? So, they have dinner that night. When they had dinner, she got a brother, and he kind of weird. He look crazy, and I don't know about this brother. He automatically start throwing little slurs, too, because he looking at Chris, he's a big, kind of, you know, kind of a tall, stocky, you know, built up kind of black guy, and he's like, do you street fight? Chris told him, no, I ain't never did no street fighting, honey. The only thing I ever did was some jiu-jitsu, or whatever that kind of karate type of thing is. Well, he think that that's soft, and he's messing with Chris about that to the point where he's about to get up and actually put Chris in a headlock, but Rose and the parents stop his ass and tell him put a pause on that and leave that shit alone. So he goes off, he's sulking, because he ready to move faster than what they actually ready to move with him, because they got to finesse Chris into this, because Chris is, he on guard. Things is just kind of strange to him at this point, okay? So that night, they laying in the bed, and you hear this buzzing sound. Now, Chris sleep, and so is Vanilla Love Drop on the side of him. She sleep. He wakes up because he hear that, and I'm thinking, like, bitch, okay, wait a minute. It's late night. It's country. But, bitch, I know in this big-ass pretty house these people got on this here estate right here, I know they got central heating and air, so why the hell is I'm hearing mosquitoes and shit? But apparently one got in because he wind up slapping one, and he gets up, and he decides he wants to go outside. I don't know what the hell made him go outside, because ain't no way in hell I would have went out that door, baby, but he did. Okay, now he out there. He about to take a cigarette when he notices Georgette is in the window. Well, she's in, he can see her through the window. She's standing up in front of his mirror, and she messing around with her forehead. But when she notices him looking at her, she quickly turns the light off in the room, and we see her leave out. Okay, as he's turning around, getting ready to light his cigarette up, we see a figure running toward him at full speed. And I'm thinking to myself, bitch, run. But he ain't run. We find out that that's the yard dude done ran past him like a thief in the night, baby. And I guess that was enough for him, because he put out that idea about trying to get that Joe in his mouth and went on back up in that house. And as soon as he walked back in that house, the mother is sitting in the sitting area, and she done popped the damn light on, talking about, come sit with me. She got her a little cup of tea, and she's sitting there talking to him, right? I'm like, child, something ain't right about this shit. I'm telling you, she's sitting there talking to him. She asking him, has he ever been hypnotized before? They back on the hypnotized thing. He ain't trying to have no conversation with her really about no hypnotizing, but he flowing with it, asking her, is she the type that do the pocket watch thing where you got to watch it, follow that, not realizing this woman is sitting here with this teacup. She got tea in there. She got a spoon, and she started stirring it, but it's making this clanking sound. And as she's doing that, he don't realize he being hypnotized right now. She took that conversation over to his mother. he didn't really want to discuss his mother, but by the time she had got through with him, he had then explained that when he was a young kid, he was at home watching TV, waiting on his mama to come home from work. Hours went by, and he didn't pick up the phone and try to call nobody. Later on, he found out that his mom had been hurt. You know, she had been hit by a car, and she laid out there for a while before she died. She bled out. If he had maybe made that phone call to get her some help, then maybe she might have survived, which is why he felt compelled to go back and check on that deer. And it's why he kind of he don't want to really talk about it too much. But she done finagled him into having this whole conversation, and he don't realize he hypnotized till he try to get up and walk out. When he try to leave, she tell him he paralyzed. And basically, she tell him, now sink. And he went down in the floor. Now, when he goes down into the floor, it's as if he's been submerged in water and he's trying to catch his balance, but he can't. But he can still see her from the opening that he fell through, okay? Next thing we know, he wakes up in a cold sweat. It's the next day. He don't know how the hell he done got from downstairs talking to the mama up to their bed and sleep. And Rose in there taking a shower. When she get out that shower, he say, look, I think your mama hypnotized me last night. She was like, oh, I'm gonna talk to daddy about that. He was like, nah, it's not that big a deal. Don't worry about it. We're gonna let that there go. But he also noticing that his phone had been unplugged and he plugged it up that night before. So as they having their little chit-chat and conversations, we hear cars approaching. So they go look out the window. And y'all, it's like a funeral procession. Everybody is in black-ass cars, and they white, okay? And they getting out these cars. So I'm like, what the hell is about to go on here? Well, he go downstairs and they mingling, he being introduced, and most of the people, they weird as hell too. They like they was in a trance, some of them people really was. And everybody he meets, they saying they already know who he is, okay? Well, he meets this one guy, and he's an artist. Well, at least he was an artist. But he ended up losing his sight due to a genetic condition. And so now he buys and sells art. And he's aware of who Chris is as well. He has someone that explains Chris' pictures so well and so detailed that he's telling Chris that he's an exquisite artist. And, you know, he got a bright future ahead of him and all of that stuff now. Okay. Think he own an art museum or something like that. So he meet that guy, dude telling him his painting, his pictures are exquisite. So next he sees a guy, and the dude seemed familiar, but the most important part about it was he was black. Because up until this point, the only black people we have seen at the parents' location is Georgette and the houseboy. I mean, the yard dude. He walk up to the man, and you know, he feeling tension because everybody is staring at Chris. Everybody staring at him. Even got one woman that told ex-Rose, is it true what they say about them? I said, girl, hell yeah, it's true. It's only that 10, it's 90% true, 10% a lie. Only 10% of us walking around like this. I'm going to leave that right there, okay? Well, he walk up, he introduce himself, and of course he taken aback because dude look like somebody he know. But what really took him aback was he with this white woman, and she appear to be about 30 to 40 years his senior, and they a fucking couple, child. Well, he sees that, and you know, that's not common ground, so he mingles some more, and like I said, he's introduced to various people, and that's when that woman asked him about ex-Rose, was it true what they say about his kind? Well, anyway, he winds up going back to talk to that black guy. I think his name was Travis. If his name ain't Travis, that's what his name is on this review. And he keep looking at him because he familiar to him. At this point, he takes his cell phone out, and he forget to remove the flash and took a picture of the man. When he took that picture of him and that flash shit, that dude, he came out that hypnotic state. First thing we saw was he started bleeding from the nose. And then as he's walking upon Chris bleeding in the nose, he tells him, get out. Now, Chris is freaked the fuck out at this point. We see Daddy get the man, Daddy Armitage get the man, and they carting him off to his wife's office. I said, mm-hmm. Baby Chris sends that pic to his TSA friend, and the friend calls saying, that's Andre from the whole neighborhood in Brooklyn. And Chris is saying, well, yeah, he looked for me, but it can't be him because this dude here is a straight up Oreo. He all black on the outside and totally white on the inside. And look how he dressed. Well, Chris tells his friend that he think that Rose mama hypnotized him too, because now every time he think about a cigarette, he's starting to feel nauseous. He thinking that it was once and he out that hypnosis, but not yet, baby. His friend urging him to get the hell up out the house. It don't sound right, and they might be hypnotizing you again, and they gonna wind up putting your ass into slavery, but not regular slavery, bitch. He said they gonna put him into sex slavery. I hollered, child. Child, he said that. But before he made that phone call, you know he had to put that phone on the charger so he can make that call, because once again, the phone is not on the charger, and he left it on there, okay? He tell him that everything all right, you know, everything will be cool, and they leaving soon. They leaving tomorrow anyway, so it ain't that big of a deal. He get off that phone, he tell Rose, look, I don't know what's going on around here, but somebody messing with my cell phone because it keep getting taken off charges. She says she gonna talk to Georgette about it. He say okay, but he tell her they need to, you know, they need to get the hell up out of there. Now, while all that is going on upstairs, downstairs, the parents emerge from the mama's office, and now the black guy, Travis, he back on track now. He done been rehypnotized. That's what happened. He come out there telling jokes and apologizing for his behavior. And as he's saying that, Chris enters the room with Rose, and he's telling her, you know, he's sorry. He's apologizing to him for how he acted. And then they decide that they're going to go on and leave, okay? So Chris and Rose decide at that point that they're going to go on and take them a walk. The parents say they're going to go out back with their guests, and they're going to do sparklers and all that kind of shit while she take him off on a walk, okay? Now, what they did was they went in the back and had a silent auction. Now, what you may wonder, is it that they auctioning? Well, I'm glad you asked. They is auctioning Chris ass. We see a picture of Chris with his camera up around his neck, and the man, they doing a silent auction, honey. They is sitting up there, and the dude with no eyes that lost his eyesight to a genetic condition, he is the one that bids and receives Chris, okay? Meanwhile, Rosen took his ass off way away from her parents. Mm-hmm. And he telling her he won't leave. He ain't feeling comfortable there. And she basically say, okay, well, you want to leave without me? Well, child, I guess white puss must be good to him, because he decided he going to stay there since they leaving the next day anyway. Child, pussy a powerful thing. You hear what I'm trying to tell y'all today? They say dick is a powerful thing. No, baby, pussy was Star Wars, and it was settle conflict. I promise you, William. Anyway, back at the house, the guest is leaving, and Georgette comes to Chris in Rose's room. She apologizing to him, talking about she was cleaning up in there, and when she was wiping down, she lifted up his phone to wipe in that spot. It came disconnected from the charger, and she just left it there since she had already disconnected that. That shit didn't sound right. Then they have this weird-ass exchange, baby. Now, I told y'all, this bitch, they smiling. She walking up on him, they talking. He feeling weird about the shit. This bitch is weird, and she's smiling, but she's steady crying. Bitch, how you crying? I'm talking about real tears. Then she bones ass about the room. I told you she walked fast, child. He told her it was okay, but baby, she walked up on him with that crying and shit. That's kind of super spooked him. He wants to get the hell up out that house, and he tell Rose, we leaving. Now, they rushing to get packed, and he at the door downstairs waiting, okay? And she fumbling with her bag, talking about she can't find the keys. He telling her, come on so we can get the hell up out of here because he ain't feeling this shit. The guest done left. He seeing shit ain't looking right around these parts. He wants to get up, get out, and get the fuck on before something happened to him, okay? Now, out in the sitting room comes Daddy asking him about the meaning of life. He says something back to him, but then out of the separate room from the side comes the mama looking weird as usual. And for some reason, Chris moved away from the damn door. And when he moved away from the damn door, he see the brother now in the living room. So it's like all of them is coming at him at one time. He is now screaming, where is the keys? She gonna look up at him and show him the keys and say, but you know I can't give them to you, babe. So now he knows she a part of the bullshit too. I knew it all along because I could tell someone right by her with the deer. But he finds out that she is now part of this. And he makes an attempt to try to go and bogart his way past her brother. Child, as soon as he touched the brother, it's like he became paralyzed again. Why? Because he's still somewhat under that hypnosis state. Child, he falls all the way back, like he paralyzed again, and he's partially unconscious, but he can hear the mom telling the dad and the brother to take him downstairs. Now, back in the city, best friend, he ain't at ease about his boy being there. He calling, he ain't getting no answer. So he started to investigate, and the first thing he did was look up that guy from the hood. His name is really Andre. That's the one that's been walking around with the nose bleeding shit I told y'all about. That's him that they kidnapped months ago. Well, from what I'm understanding, this dude done been missing for 6 damn months, okay? His name Andre. And he contemplating instead of calling but ain't getting no answer on the voicemail. So he decides he gonna go talk to the police, and that's when we see none other than Maxine Shaw, attorney at law from Living Single, Erica Alexander, for those of y'all who may not know her by Maxine Shaw. And he explained the case. You know, my friend been gone for 2 days straight. He ain't answering his phone. That's not like him. I'm caretaking his dog for him. He went up there to his girlfriend's parents' home. He told me that he thought that they may have hypnotized him and they might be trying to put him in some form of slavery, preferably the sexual kind. Well, next thing we know, she goes and gets these 2 other detectives, and the TSA best friend got to run that scenario down again. And at the end of it, they basically bust out laughing at him because, you know, he's saying that, you know, that's what he done put together in his mind. They don't feel like he sound mind, really, but they ain't do nothing to him. They just didn't help him. So he done reached a dead end there. Now, let's go back to Amityville. Kristen woke up and he in a room with a chair, but his hands and feet are bound. He in a leather chair. His feet and hand are bound. And there is a deer head above him, right in front of him on the wall. And there's this old-fashioned, floor model TV sitting in front of him. TV pop on. You got this older couple talking about how great their family is. And at the end of it, they saying that you may be lucky enough to become a member of their family. I'm like, what kind of weird shit is this? And then it switches to the picture of the mother's teacup again with the spoon and the stirring around, clinking and shit. And dad puts him back under. He goes out again. Back in the city, best friend still pressed. He want to know where Chris and is he okay? So he attempts to call the phone again. This time, Rose answered that phone. He relieved and he asked him where Chris is. She lying, talking about he left 2 days ago via cab. Well, he said he went to the police. She immediately, well, what did you tell them? Just that I hadn't seen him in a couple of days. So he begins to ask her, you know, what cab company did he get in? And she talking about, I think it was a local cab company. Then the bitch turned around and said it was an Uber. Bitch, Uber a cab, name one. He knows she lying, but he not sure how to, you know, really deal with it. So he plays her on a hole as he try to figure out what he should do next. But she ain't stupid. He decided he gonna record her and get her incriminating herself. Again, she ain't stupid. When he got back on that phone, she started talking about, "Won't you talk about what you really want to talk about? I see that you've been flirting with me. You always flirting with me when we're on the phone, when we go places." So basically, she coming at him like he calling her because he trying to holler at her, not thinking, bitch, he called his friend phone. What the fuck? Okay. Well, he get frustrated because he ain't trying to holler at her, girl. He just want to know where his friend is at. He gets so damn frustrated with her, he wind up hanging up on her ass. And when he hung up on her ass, we see that her parents were standing there the whole time listening to everything that she's saying to this dude on his phone. Well, Chris wake up again, and he's scratching and clawing on that leather chair trying to get them ropes and belts and shit off of him. He winds up cutting that damn leather with his fingernails, and you see cotton popping out of that. Keep that in mind. Okay. The TV comes on again. This time is dude from the art dude, the gallery dude, okay? He tells him basically, "I bought you and I bought you for your eyesight. That's what I need so I can get out of this constant state of darkness." And we see that he's in a hospital gown and he tells the person, "I'm done." So he cuts it off. The next vision is the teacup again with the spoons. And from what it appears, Chris passed out again, okay? Now, Daddy Doctor, the neurosurgeon, he got a whole room set up downstairs where he got his scrubs on, child. He got two gurneys. One of the gurneys got the art dude on there unconscious. He got IV set up for Chris. He already got this dude under an IV. He's sedated. We see him actually take some surgical equipment and cut into the man's skull. Okay, he ain't talking to me. But anyway, he cut into his skull and we see him remove the brain and he send his son to go get Chris. Now, he rolls into there thinking that Chris is back under a hypnotic state. But what had happened was Chris was smart. He had somehow got some of that cotton up out that cushion of that chair and put it in his ears. And when he put that in his ears, that kept that teacup from putting him back into another trance. So he's sitting there playing the role like he sleep, but he ain't. Soon as their brother let them arms and them legs loose, he took a object that was sitting on the table right next to the chair he was bound in and bust him across his head two good times. Now, Daddy is wondering, what's taking Gerard, I think that's his damn name, or Jared or some shit, what's taking him so long? So Daddy step out in the hallway only to be gutted by the deer head that was on the table, that was up on the wall. Kristen took that down and he gutted the shit out of him and his throat ran up out in this region right up in him. He gutted the hell out of him. So now he got blood all over him. He done bust the sun across his head two good damn time, and we see blood running. So we think he out of it. He walks into the kitchen area and see Georgette. She see him. She know what time it is. She take off running. He don't go after her ass or nothing, baby. He continues to walk through this house. I guess he's trying to find keys so he can get the hell on. Well, upon him traveling through the house, he runs upon a room where the mama is at. They staring at each other, but right in front of both of them, within reach, is that teacup. She know if she get to that teacup, she can put him back under. He know if she get up under, get to that teacup, he going back under. He gonna wind up losing his brain, because that's what the hell they want. They want to take his brain. That's what they've been doing to people, taking their damn brains. So, he knocks that coffee cup down. It breaks. I think he knocked her the fuck out, and he goes to try to go out that door. But remember the brother that we thought was dead back there in that room from being busted across his head? No, he tries to fight again. Chris winds up whooping that ass and getting up out that house. He goes out there in the same car that I told you guys that they kidnapped that guy from in the beginning of the movie. It's the car the brother. So that was the brother that kidnapped that guy 6 months earlier. He gets in his car and he's driving away. All of this been going on. Rose is upstairs online finna get ready to hook up with her another man and get his goods. And she got headphones on, so she don't hear all the commotion. But when he hit Georgette, because when he was driving away from the plantation, he ended up hitting Georgette, okay? When he hit Georgette ass, it kind of made a noise, and she became aware. She gets downstairs, and she's got this shotgun in her hand. She's trying to shoot, right? He hit Georgette, and like I said, because he had that experience with his mother where he didn't go check to see if she was all right, he now feels compelled to go and check on this woman. He don't just check on the bitch. He put the bitch in the car with him, not realizing something wrong with Georgette, too. What's wrong with Georgette is really the grandmother. When the grandmother and the grandfather died, the daddy and the mama put them people's brains into the caretaker's brain cells, took their brains and put their brains in there so that they would continue to live on. That's what the hell happened. So when this woman wakes up, he's driving, trying to get them away from there. She like, you done messed up the plan, and goes to fighting him to the point where he crashes. Okay, they both passed out for a minute. Next thing we know, we see him coming through, but grandma must be dead because she ain't moved no more. And he's getting ready to get out the car, and Rose shoot at him with the shotgun. He get out the car, and he's trying to run away, but the caretaker, the groundskeeper, he's still there. We see her said, tell him, get him, grandpa. That's the man, the grandpa that was supposed to have ran in the Olympics, but Jesse Owens beat him out. That's who he is. So he runs and catches up with the boy. He catches up with Chris. He get him down on the ground. She walks up on him. He tell her, let me shoot him. So she thinking, because his brain is the brain of her granddaddy, that everything that he was, the man was, but prior to having his brain extracted, you don't lose yourself completely. It still be a portion of you, but a very minute portion of you. That new brain and the hypnosis is what keeps these people continuously doing whatever it is they supposed to be doing, or whatever the mother and father want them to do, for them to anyway. So he gets the gun like he gonna shoot Chris. He shoot Rose in her gut, but she ain't dead. Now, we wondering at this point, is he finna shoot, gonna shoot Chris, because he done went back into his right state of mind, which is the new brain, okay? The old brain made him shoot Rose. The new brain, he thinking, okay, he finna shoot me. But the dude has to take the gun and shoot his own damn head off. And the reason why he did that is because he knew that it was only going to be a short period of time to where he returns to his normal self and he can do it. And he don't want to go back to being this shell of a person that they created him to be, okay? So he shoots himself. Rose is trying to get to the gun. He gets up. Chris gets up, and he's on top of her. This bitch gonna start trying to play him. I love you. I never wanted anything bad to happen to you. Knowing that the dude had loved her, she figured like if she appealed to him, he'll turn around and trust her, and she can get that gun and shoot his ass. Because at this point, ain't nobody doing no brain surgery because everybody in the house dead. Child. Soon as he started choking the shit out of her, we see these lights coming. And you can tell it's police lights. So we thinking, here come the popo. This bitch here start doing what they always do. Help! Like Kristen did something to her. But what she didn't know was that was the guy from the TSA. He done stole the TSA airport and them people damn car. And then come to get his damn friend. Chris get in that car. Baby, the friend said, I told you not to go up in that house. And baby, they back up and they leave. And that was the end of the damn movie. I got what this was. I get it. You know, upon sitting here a couple of hours and pondering this shit, I kind of understand where they're going with it. It's like modern day slavery. It ain't happening, but it can happen. And in some instances, if you look at certain parts of this movie, you will see exactly where he's going with this. I still don't feel like it deserves the hype that it's gotten, but it was okay. It wasn't something that I was like, fuck my money, I'm walking out on this shit, I ain't dealing with it. It wasn't no situation like that. I did stick through the whole movie, and I did walk away feeling like it getting way more pressed than what it probably should. Now, that's just my personal opinion. I would advise you, I'm not going to recommend it to my friends, but for, I would tell a person this, go see for yourself. It ain't shit. I could have waited for this to come out on DVD. That's how I feel about it. But he had valid points in it. It was a way of looking at how slavery go. I mean, well, how racism works today. Okay. You know, they can't put you in the field and whoop your ass like they used to. They got diplomatic ways of doing this thing now, and I feel like that's what they're doing. But that's it, y'all. That was the movie in its entirety. If I left anything out, which I didn't leave out too much, a few scenes here and there to condense it down. But if it's anything you want to discuss in the comments, feel free to do that. Just let's keep it respectful. This is just an open conversation about a movie I've seen. Again, I'll be back soon with Love & Hip Hop. The premiere episode tonight. I still have to do Tangled and Twisted episode 6. If you guys are into that, please go and subscribe to the channel and watch the episode so you'll be able to follow me on the review. And that's it. Remember, y'all, the depth of your struggle will determine the height of your success, baby. You ain't gonna get there without going through something. So stay encouraged. In the meantime, in between time, remember to like this video. Please leave a comment down in the comment section and share this video on all your social media sites. I'll see you guys on the next video. Peace.